It's recording. We're not going to use this in a court of law or anything. I just know the team here was asking, hey, are you recording it? I'm like, yes, of course we are. Apologies for the vacuuming sounds. I'm actually traveling and I'm in a hotel right now, and they seem to think that this was a good time to vacuum. So hopefully you can hear me okay. I could go outside and beg them to stop, I guess. I don't know. Hopefully it'll stop.
Yeah, they can't stay there too long, can they?
I can't imagine how much, I mean, unless they're like disposing of dead bodies or something, it's got to be like pretty thin. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So I'll just leave it to you kind of to tell us a little bit about you and what you do. And I've been raving about you becoming a LinkedIn expert as of late. And so.
Sure. So who here likes technology? Show of hands. Like half of you don't like technology. I hear you. So I like to tell everybody that I'm a recovering technologist. I worked my way all the way up to being a CTO before I started NowSourcing 11 and a half years ago. And part of why I left technology is exactly like why we're doing this like 20 minutes late, because at best technology works half the time. Because then, like, you know, the internet isn't working, the router's not working, where's the Wi-Fi? You know, Zoom doesn't want to work. Oh, should we use like Skype or whatever? And then like, it's so frustrating. But that's why we're all in social media marketing here, right? So that's great. So after kind of just having enough of all of that sort of stuff, I just decided really people just wanted things to just know that everything was going to be okay. They didn't want to hear like fancy acronyms. It's just like, just make the internet, leave me alone with all this tech garbage. So I'm like, wow, that kind of sounds like marketing. And I had like some, you know, I did social psychology and things like that and game theory and all sorts of stuff like that in undergrad. And I really wanted to just start my own business. I just kind of had the entrepreneurial bug after working enough in corporate America and startup land and all that kind of stuff. So in the early days, I actually did websites and stuff like that. But I really didn't think that that was enough of a key differentiator, because you know, if you all go to the store, you buy milk, you might like whole milk, right? And so you'll buy, you know, the one with the red cap, you'll make sure that it's not expired. I mean, I know you're college students, you might just grab the first one, but really you might want to make sure it's not expired. And you might check to see that milk isn't like $50 a gallon, but you don't care what brand it is, you don't really care how much it is. You're just getting the milk for your cereal or whatever you're doing, and you're on your way. Meaning to say, a lot of that stuff in today's world and most products and services that we have in life are commodities, and we have unlimited choices through all of what we can do on the internet, through what we can do with asking our friends, through what we can do in local searches and all of that. So back in what seems like a lifetime ago, NowSourcing was a very early on social media agency. Back when it was like, what even is that? Like, I would go into companies, I kid you not, and I would tell them, like, you know, your businesses really need to be up on Facebook and Twitter and this and that. And people would, like, laugh me out of their office. And they'd be like, what, are you crazy? Like, why would we have a business on Facebook? Back in the day, you couldn't even have, like, a business account on Facebook. People would have to break terms of service, and it would literally, hey, are we frozen? Can anybody see or hear me? It looks like it's frozen on your end. Hello? Uh-oh. There we go. Okay. Yeah. We good? Where'd we, it looks like you guys, I'm like, wow, you guys are paying so much attention, but really, like, it was just frozen. What was the last thing you heard?
Milk.
Milk, okay. So milk's a commodity, like everything else in life. So you really kind of have to stand out and all that. So I decided that just building websites and stuff like that wasn't really for us. So we were actually in a very, very early on social media agency. I'm talking like 2006, 2007, where I would go into companies, into their boardroom, and I would tell them their businesses, you know, guys, you need to be on Facebook, you need to be on Twitter, you need to be on all these things. And they would be like, that's crazy. Why would businesses need to be on Facebook? And I would get like laughed out of their businesses. They'd call back like a few years later because they'd know that we were right. But like back in the day, like on Facebook, you would have to break their terms of service. And instead of having like a Facebook page, you'd have to have like a user. They let you like eventually like migrate your users over and stuff. It was crazy. So it was totally the Wild West. We were the first place to do social for places like John Deere. We did some stuff for Jay-Z when Blueprint 2 came out. We did all sorts of like crazy stuff. But by the end of the 2000s, I thought it was getting insane where like everybody thought they could do social. Y'all have friends that think that they're good at social media because they can like log on to Twitter and Facebook and Snapchat. There's a lot more to it, right? Like Krista will tell you. There's a lot of things that you have to know, and there's speaking in other people's voices, and there's analytics, and there's social listening, and a million other things you need to know. So just because you log on to something and you're below age X doesn't mean you're a magic social media guru, wizard, expert, whatever people are calling themselves. So I don't know. I felt like the market was getting really crowded, and I think, and this is, I would say, good practical advice for everyone, it's really good to pick a very specific niche and specialty. So we looked at all the skills and strengths and assessments of the team, and it's like, all right, we're really good at viral marketing and just crashing servers. Like back in the day, if anybody remembers dig.com, that used to be like a really big thing. I know it's still around, but it's totally different. Back in the day, there were like 100 people that ran 50% of what was on the homepage, like curating it, getting to the front page. So I was like one of those people. So we knew how to like crash servers, get all sorts of media and press and traffic and attention. We were great storytellers and we were great artists. So I'm like, all right, well, what can we do? Just like rolling that all up. And back in the late 2000s, there were basically like a handful of people making infographics. Show of hands, everybody knows what an infographic is. I think Krista's, yeah. You know what it is, right? Okay, good. So I don't need to, like pretty pictures for people that can't read because we have no attention span anymore. Yeah. Hopefully I'm not losing you all. I'm going to keep picking on everybody. And I may even ask for a few brave volunteers in a little bit. So nothing scary and all at will. So yeah, you know, I'm looking around. There were basically like a handful of people across the world making infographics back then. And infographics that long ago kind of were terrible and they had a lot of typos. They really weren't good at telling stories. They looked awful. So I'm like, wow, we can like roll in all this great stuff that we're doing into a really nice type product. So we basically helped shape the industry over the last better part of the last decade. We've done thousands of these. We've done them for all sorts of like Fortune 500s and tech startups. We've done some pretty legendary campaigns helping companies get funded, acquired. Once upon a time, I think we almost broke Facebook's IPO when it came out. We've helped a basketball player get a huge contract, all sorts of crazy stuff. And we can walk through different examples. But I know we also want to talk about LinkedIn. So everybody gets like infographics, why they're important. People can't read if you're just looking at pages and pages of text. We can show some of those. I can screen share in a little bit. I also wanted to talk about LinkedIn because I feel like this is something that generally is not taught well enough in schools. So like you'll have a career counselor and they'll be like, yeah, apply for internships and yes, get a dance. Here we go. We're going to make the technology work. Like, do we all have to like clap to like make it work? I'm not sure. Basically, the internet is like held together by bubble gum and scotch tape. So I'm not too surprised, but you kind of caught what I was saying with infographics and stuff.
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, cool. And you heard what I was saying about LinkedIn a little bit?
No, we missed LinkedIn.
Okay, so LinkedIn is not exactly like a startup. It didn't just come out yesterday. Is everybody in the class on LinkedIn right now?
I make them.
You make them. All right, well, you should want to on your own accord, everybody. Let me put it this way. Like, it's not like a new startup. It's not just something like everybody's just heard about. It's been out for probably close to 15 years. They make billions of dollars. Microsoft bought them last year for $26 billion. And what's nice is it can get you pretty much anything you want in this lifetime. And that sounds like hyperbole, but I assure you it's not. Like, we win all sorts of business and speaking gig, all sorts of ridiculous stuff. I've helped people get jobs. Like, whatever you can imagine is kind of like just in the palm of your hand on LinkedIn. I'll do some math for you. So there's 530 million people on LinkedIn. I would tell you there's probably about, right now, there's probably like 1,000 people in the world that are using LinkedIn correctly. So I'd like to, if there are any brave volunteers for the class, I'm gonna screen share and put somebody's profile up there and maybe we can even just have a little fun and pick on your profile, but only like for constructive criticism to make it good. If nobody wants to be brave, maybe Krista could do it or I could do it. Who's brave?
Let's try out Aaron Brown.
Come on up so I can hear you.
Let's have a let's start with Tanner, because Aaron volunteered, but he has a very common name. How about Tanner Sutcliffe?
So can you write your name in chat, please?
And yeah, let's see.
Or just quick, just give me like a link to your LinkedIn profile.
Did you get that?
Okay. Yep. Hey, Tanner.
I wonder if I can. Maybe if you send me,
Yeah, I'm bringing it up. It's okay. So there's only two people named Tanner Sutcliffe in all of LinkedIn, and one is a full-time student at ACU. So I think we got it. Unlike Brian Wallace, where there's like 500,000 of us. So good for you, man. You won the name lottery for that. Okay, so I am going to share my screen, and I'm actually going to pull up my profile, not because I'm like an egomaniac, but just to show you like a comparative view of stuff that I do and stuff that you do, okay? We're gonna switch the screen here to do some screen share. Let me know when we can see. We good?
Yes.
Technology works? What? Crazy. Okay, so you should see Tanner's profile up on the screen. Yeah?
Yeah.
And this is mine over here. So I'm going to kind of switch back and forth a little bit. And I can send everybody this later if you guys want to take notes and all this. This is the part everybody wants to pay attention. So stop playing with cats on the internet, because this will make you money and get you jobs and all this stuff. For sure. Like, for real. Because there's just so much stuff that even like the LinkedIn experts and trainers, a lot of people are using like a playbook from 5 years ago, and they don't really understand the stuff that myself and a few of my friends have uncovered. I'd say over the last 6, 12, 18 months, LinkedIn has just become a ridiculous powerhouse that if you use it right, it's just ridiculous. So in short, before we go through Tanner and I explain this in greater detail, let's just start with a high level. So there's, to be really good at LinkedIn, you need to do the following things. One, have an amazing profile. Two, be really good at something. I know it's hard to be good at something, but to be good at something. Two, part B on number two is not only you have to be good at something, but you have to explain it in a, like a short way that people can understand it. Right. So if you ask people on LinkedIn, what does Brian do? Oh, he's the infographic guy that also does all this crazy stuff on LinkedIn. So if people can reduce your life in a sentence, that sounds terrible, but like for business purposes, it's actually pretty useful. And then step three is to make amazing content. Then obviously there's like a ton of actual work you have to do, but those are the three basic principles that we try to share. And that's really what we get. So any questions on that? Anybody want to challenge me on that or thinks they have a better idea? Certainly happy to argue to the death with you, but I assure you it's a real thing. And also,
I'm making them read Mark Schaefer's book, Known, and they're going to have to come down to that one sentence, and then they have to write 5 blog posts and share them on LinkedIn.
So. Awesome. Good. Awesome.
I'm doing the right thing.
Okay, good. So one other thing, I want to do just a quick little thing. So if everybody can, it's a little thought experiment, a little physical activity I usually do when I give different lectures and presentations, through the web or in person. So I'm going to prove to you that we're all scared and we're afraid to put our best out there. Ready? Please, everybody, raise your hand as high as you can. Now raise it higher. Like, you could literally, like, you could stand up, on your chair, you could jump off of the chair and, like, climb through the ceiling, right? But nobody does, right? Why don't they? You can put your hands down. Oh, look, yeah, we got one person up there. Good. Who is that?
That was Aaron Brown, or AB.
Okay. Aaron's going to go far because he's not afraid of what he looks like to everybody else in the room. That's a big piece of luck. It sounds just stupid and ridiculous, but most of us hold ourselves back with fear to the point where it is absurd. We're afraid to put ourselves out there. We're afraid to dance. We're afraid to, what people are going to say, right? Like, while you guys were doing it, everybody probably looked around to their neighbor, to their left and to their right and in front and in back. And you're like, well, I'm going to kind of go like this. I don't know. I don't want to look stupid. All right, fine. I'll go like that. And if you noticed, if you were looking around, everybody like kept kind of inching up, but only Aaron actually bothered to like totally stand up. Aaron, were you touching the ceiling literally?
Yep.
Yeah, you were like going through the ceiling. You were ready to bust through those tiles. So people who kind of have that natural inclination really can take that far. Like, go far enough without being like a sociopath. Like, I'm not saying like be insane, right? But having that kind of mindset will help you with all the stuff that we're about to go through. Okay, everybody good with that so far? All right, so we're gonna go back to Tanner on the screen. And since Aaron was so brave with that, I think we probably have enough time to do more than one profile. Aaron, what's your full name?
Aaron Joseph Brown.
I had him email me his link, so I could probably just chat you the link real quick.
Send me a chat, and we'll also pull that up too. While we're doing it, we might as well get everybody's up here.
Although I won't.
And Chris, I just added you on.
Okay. You haven't done that yet?
I know. I've been updating my...
It's not letting me exit full screen now. Before it did. Is that because you're screen... Oh, it's because you're screen sharing, so I can't send you...
Oh, got it. All right. I'm going to stop screen sharing for a minute so we can do that. Yep.
There we go.
Here we go. Hi.
Did you send to me, Aaron? Sorry. Do I have to go to LinkedIn to get it?
It's super
plain
right now, by the way.
So.
That's okay.
Would you say it's not that good yet? You forgot to add some. It doesn't matter. It's all right.
Okay.
Everybody always forgets to put their latest thing and all that. And it's funny because a lot of people think it has to be complete and this and that. And a lot of that stuff is really just kindergarten level. Like, yes, you have to complete your profile, but what do you do after the 10 minutes that you do that? Right. So there's basically the top portion of it. There we go. The top portion of it is everything.
Okay.
Okay, good. All right. So I've got it. And now, okay. Now that I have all of your profiles, I'm going to go back to screen share. Here we go. Let me know when you can see it. Are we good?
Not yet. There we go. We're good.
Let's see how fast it moves between the screens. I'm going to go from Tanner to Aaron to me. Pretty fast. Good. Okay. We can do it in real time. Beautiful. Okay. So imagine somebody is going to see your profile for the first time. You basically have a couple of seconds for somebody to make some sort of objective opinion about your entire life and a dating app or whatever. They're going to swipe the wrong way and you're going to be gone forever, right? So instead, most people are okay, I have to do everything with the experience and education and endorsements and recommendations and all this stuff. And I would say before you even worry about all that, there's tons of stuff that needs to happen at the top. So if you want to project something about what you do, the last thing you're going to want to do, nobody's going to want to put a picture of where they live in the background or anything like that. I did say you have to be brave here, and I'm going to pick on you a little bit, but don't feel bad because everybody does this. Everybody has a cityscape, some place that they're passionate about in the background. I don't really hang out in Phoenix that much. I assume that's a picture of somewhere out there, but if you're trying, Tanner, to go get hired or you're trying to start your business, literally, what does that have to do with anything? It's useless, right? It's slightly better than that boring generic background, but there's so much more we can do. And this is the often, even all the experts, they always don't bother to maximize the use of this. The other thing is most people don't go and look at what it looks like on mobile. You have a very narrow, stretched little canvas here. So that it kind of sucks what we're limited to doing. So let's just go through all three of our profiles while we're talking about this. We're just going to go top down. So Aaron is doing even worse, right? Because he's just got the generic. You knew that was coming. Okay. So let's look at mine. So I like to speak. I like to talk about LinkedIn and I do infographics. So I'm at LinkedIn's headquarters giving a presentation about content marketing and infographics. So I'm not saying you all have to be professionals while you're in, just starting out, but there's something you can do where you can have something going on there, right? So I'll just show you a funny example of somebody else. So we have somebody fairly new to the team here, and I was explaining this. I've been training him a little bit. So let's say hi to Josh for a second, right? So Josh didn't really know what to do. So one day when we were, giving a presentation at a client, he stood in front of a smart board, looking intelligent, giving a presentation about cats on the internet. Right? So like you can stage any, you know, you can just, you know, get up to the front of the class, right? Like if you're giving a presentation and somebody can take your picture, it should be something just showing that you have some level of proficiency in what it is you're trying to do. So I should probably back up a second and say, okay, Tanner, what do you actually want to do? Let's try that.
Well, I'd love to be a writer.
Great. So, you know, if there's a picture of you literally like writing, or you could be like funny and retro and you could be like furiously typing on a typewriter, you know, like advancing the paper, just something that primes the brain of an impression of what it is you do, right? And not crappy stock art either, but like something actual, something real, okay? How about you, Aaron? What do you want to do? You don't want to just connect lines when you grow up. So what do you want to do?
I got a picture for you. See what I can do with it.
Oh, you're going to put it in real time? Aaron's like, oh, no, I'm so embarrassed. I got to fix it right now. You can fix it now. Go for it. Add it. Okay, so let's keep going down. Also, one other thing. You can see the URL here. So we've got linkedin.com/in/ If you had to tell somebody what this was, it's painful because it's got all these dashes and numbers and all this. And Tanner's got all that too, right? You'll notice that I don't. Mine's nice and simple. So I can just tell people it's linkedin.com/in/nowsourcing. That's a really easy fix that you want to do today. When you go into your profile over here on the right where it says edit public profile and URL, you click on that screen and it's right here. You hit that little pencil and you're good. Like, you know, Tanner's pretty easy because he's got, you know, a name that there's only two people on LinkedIn apparently. But Aaron has my problem where there's probably a million Aaron Browns. So you may have to get a little creative. Maybe you need a middle initial, middle name. You'll figure it out, Aaron. But something just real easy fix for everybody to do, okay? All right. So let's keep on going. So now we've got your profile picture. Here's a picture of Tanner. Looks pretty good. Here's a picture of Aaron. Looks pretty good. Here's a picture of me. Mine's a little weird, if you notice. I'm looking like sideways, and I also have a filter on it. I don't know if you guys noticed, but in the last 6 months or so, LinkedIn actually rolled it out where you can actually apply filters to your picture, just like you would on Instagram. Pretty cool and worth experimenting. I just turned my head to the side just because I wanted to stand out. There's a wonderful website that you may want to check out called Photo Feeler, and you can actually take your LinkedIn profile image and like 50 different people anonymously across the internet will give you feedback on how authoritative you look, on how smart you look, how dependable you look, and give specific feedback. Like, you know, I wish the lighting was better. This person is not professionally dressed. This looks like a dating photo. You know, it gives you like these pre things to add into your profile. Take it with a grain of salt. They won't, you know, I mean, it's still up to you, but it just gives you really interesting dimensional knowledge about your profile. So you may want to actually try out different pictures and just see what people will say. And you may find that, you know, in one, they'll say you're, you know, 85% smart, and the other, you'll be 25% smart. What's wrong with this picture is you're the same person, right? So that's kind of weird. But seriously, try it out. It's very interesting. No major terrible pictures or anything like that. They look pretty professionally done. Sometimes people have just terrible pictures and it's like, guys, you really need to fix this. Okay, I'm going to go through a few other things here at the top. These are fairly controversial and I don't care, but they work. So let me ask you, everybody, judging by my name, what do I do for a living? I don't sell fishing boats, right? I'm an infographic guy. Do I like calling myself an expert? Not really, but when people are searching for infographics, it's just easy to do. Also, if I publish an article, in the URL it says Brian Wallace Infographic Expert, which is indexed in Google, so that ain't bad. LinkedIn doesn't exactly recommend it, but it's like they don't also tell me to take a hike. So if you actually want to do this, you hit the little pencil over here, and you'll notice my name is Brian Wallace, comma, Infographic Expert. I also sometimes recommend putting in emojis on my name. I actually a lot of people have been talking with me about that, and I use emojis in a lot of my content marketing within LinkedIn. I've taken out, I used to have a little crystal ball emoji because it looks cool, and a lot of people say I predict future trends in social, so it was just kind of neat, or you think you're a wizard or whatever. It was kind of cool, but it was very difficult to tag me in posts, so that's why I took it out. You'll also notice in this corner, I have this little orange badge. That means that I'm a LinkedIn premium member. I think right now it costs like $100 a month. It's good for different reasons. The main reason I use it is because it looks like it's some sort of official thing. The other thing is I think they actually algorithmically list you higher when people are looking for stuff. The main reason I use it is because if you look at who's viewed your profile, if you have a free account, they only show you like the last five. I have like hundreds and hundreds of people all the time looking at me and what I do. So to look at who's looking at me, I need that just for that. Right now, if you have a small amount of people, you don't really need it. Everybody good so far?
Yes.
Cool. So I don't know if you have to change your name and all that, but this next part is where pretty much everybody I've ever seen fails dramatically because they don't understand the power of it. So people look at this and they're like, wow, that's amazing, right? Like just this line generates conversations that lead to business and speaking engagements and all sorts of stuff. So I don't expect you to be on a board at Google and a founder and making 2,000 things and being featured in the media, but everybody has some kind of claim to fame, even if it's something just funny or interesting. Most people just go with whatever LinkedIn throws in. So let's see what you guys came up with. So you've got the full-time student at Arizona Christian University. I'd say that it's a little bland, and the problem with it is you already have that you're there, right? So it's kind of repetitive. So I don't love that. It's not terrible, but I know that we can do better with it. Let's look at Aaron. So Aaron's kind of the same sort of thing. He at least has like something a little more narrow. So it's like, student athlete and Nike. So it's like, it's already priming my brain for something going on, right? So hey, did you put in a background picture yet?
In process.
All right, well, I'm reloading the page and not there. Oh, well, all right. Well, you're still working on it. So I would say that's your opportunity to really shine. I was helping somebody who's going to a local university out here, and he is at a pretty hard university and he has like a 3.9 grade point average. So I told him write like, you know, a 3.9 high achiever student or something, you know, just like something that's cool and interesting because, you know, as people are reading through hundreds of different profiles, this is the difference between a yes and a no. This is the difference between a connect and goodbye. Right? And this is stuff that is way different than everything that people are going to tell you about resumes and all that kind of stuff. This really gives you the opportunity to shine in a three-dimensional manner because you can do videos, you can do all sorts of things that really define you that other people can't do. So let's talk, everybody cool with that? So let's keep going. Let's look at the next line. So the next line does two things. It shows people where you currently work and whichever school you go to that they want to see. Now, you may not see it in here, but I'm wearing a yarmulke. I'm a Jewish person. So I'm assume, you know, it's not called Arizona Atheist University. So there are religious undertones to the university that you're at. Not everybody likes talking about politics and religion on the internet. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. No chuckles. All right. Yeah. It's pretty rough. So, I mean, you ever try to talk about like literally anything on Facebook? You could be like, I have a cat. And people would be like, why do you have a cat? Oh, this is terrible. It's the worst thing in the world. Right? Like people can't control themselves when it comes to like Facebook and stuff like that, which is why it's kind of, I don't know. And some people would tell you it's kind of falling out of favor. They just did a whole thing where they're like, we're going to show more in friends and family because we're just making everybody upset. They're trying to curate things. LinkedIn's community is very interesting and they love talking about things that are positive and uplifting. Stories about founders, things about getting a job, things about the interview process, and we'll go through some examples of content, but it's really fascinating. But it's really great to put, you know, this is your chance to put some cool stuff in here. So you've got your school and you've got where you are. Nike sure sounds great, Aaron.
Oh, it's a great company.
Yeah. Not to say that this also doesn't sound great to Tanner, but it's, you know, not as cool as Nike, and that's fine. I mean, you know, I put my company on there. It just gives you the opportunity of different stuff. I have different degrees, so I just put this degree. And then the last line also tells you where you are, and it shows you the number of connections. Guess what? I actually do have more than 500 connections. But once you hit 500 connections, it doesn't show you any more than that. So your goal is to get over 500 connections. So that way, you don't have to worry about that. Tanner, come on, man. There's 23 people in this. How many people are in your class? Aren't there like more than 23 people like sitting next to you? Come on, bro. Like, just connect with everybody right now. Aaron's probably done that already because he's up to 75. Honestly, most people that are in college like severely underutilize this, and it's not terrible, but if you can find your way to network. I mean, I have a buddy named Tim. Let's take a look at Tim for a second. Tim's in college. Tim goes to the University of Texas at Austin, and he's like has a massive, massive following. And this is taking too long to load. So we'll come back to Tim in a minute. Just trust me, he's got a whole bunch of connections. So that doesn't mean like accept everybody. So there are some people on LinkedIn. It's a little outdated, but sometimes next to a person's name, you're gonna see the acronym LION, L-I-O-N. If anybody's ever seen that and wonders what it means, it means LinkedIn Open Networker. That just means like literally they'll just connect with anybody in the world. I don't really believe in that. I think that's kind of a little weird. I think you should be a little bit selective. That's really difficult to get into at length with all the time that we have. So if you want to go back, we can get to specific questions about that. But let's go a little further, and then we can open it up for some questions. So, oh, and I will connect with you guys here. Now you'll notice I didn't say, hi, I would like to connect with you on my professional network on LinkedIn, robot. I'm doing something that's kind of funny. I'm putting in a smiley face. If we didn't know each other and we weren't actually on a live broadcast right now, do you think Tanner would accept my connection? Of course he would, right? I mean, hopefully, but most likely yes, right? So when you do things like that, don't just hit connect, add a note, put in the note. And then you say, but Brian, I'm on mobile and it's not there. I assure you it is. There, you just have to hit the three dots and then it says add a personalized message. So hopefully these guys will take the hint and accept me. And once they accept me, here's the cool part. Since I do content like crazy every day, I will be in your feed like every single day. You will see what I'm doing. So rather than what a lot of marketers will have you do where it's like, oh, get everybody's email and then just start sending them emails and drive them crazy. Like, does anybody actually enjoy getting email? Not really, right? So here, you can just kind of be like part of my life. And like, just as I chronicle and journal what I'm doing personally and professionally, you can be like, oh, look, there's Brian. There's what he's doing. And then if you want to connect with me about some business thing or something later, I'm kind of like always front of mind, which is one of the greatest tricks in the world about LinkedIn. Now let's spend a minute talking about this little thing called the summary. There is not a lot of stuff in Tanner's summary, even before we read it. How about Aaron? Uh-oh. Did I lose you?
We're back.
Okay, good. What did we miss? Look at this. Look at this. Aaron's got a whole thing in the background. He's chopping off a child's head, which I don't love, but that's it's pretty cool. And this guy's like mostly cut out. Maybe crop it a little bit, man, where like this guy's either in or out. This person's mostly in. That's pretty good. And like if we could just somehow get this kid, if we like chop off the bottom maybe or something, it's just a little creepy. I don't like, that's just a little weird, but this is very good, right? So it's like you are saying like, I'm a student, I'm an athlete, and I speak to the youth of America, and we got them all Nike shirts for something. And it's enough to be like, oh wow, let me go check and see what this guy's got. So Aaron is already building like this cult of personality, which is amazing. That's a very tight shot. But your summary basically has nothing. Let me show you my summary. Again, this is not to brag, but this is so you understand, I have like paragraphs of stuff. I have so much stuff that if you look at and read and go to all the links in here, this is like the equivalent of 2 hours learning about my life history, personally and professionally, like everything that I've done and how I've gotten to now, right? So, and it's kind of like funny and conversational. Don't write in the third party. You're not that important. Like, oh, Tanner is the blah, 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 blah. No, none of that crap. So I say stuff like, hi, I'm Brian. I come from a faraway land called Brooklyn. But if you ever hear me speak, I'm a non-regional weatherman dialect because I'm from the suburbs. And then I talk about some of my college stuff. I talk about how I do different work with people. I talk about how I was tired of working in technology. I talk about before I left work, I had a devastating event that changed the trajectory of my life. And then I write, if you really want to know, here's a link to a podcast that a lot of people have heard. You'll notice it's not clickable. That's because LinkedIn sometimes sucks and it's a little behind. Okay, whatever, it's fine. But then I'm like, yeah, after that, I had to rethink everything. I started moving in the Midwest, now to the present. And then I kind of get into like a little bit more about like what my company does. Here's a link to about stuff about my clients. Here's a thing that shows a case study. And then I'm like, while people are interested in me, if you want to chat with me, here's my email. Hey, Brian, are people going to spam you? Who cares? Use the unsubscribe button. Here's my office number. And if they really want, they can book a time to my calendar. I kid you not, guys and gals. People literally like book time with me, and I've never even heard of them before. Like people across the world just like talk to me. You'll notice it says Brian 15. I've had to like shorten it to like 15-minute blocks, or I wouldn't have enough time in the day. That's how powerful this is. You'll also notice under that there's some different media things, right? So some of these are videos, some of these things are links to press or stuff about me, and you'll notice they're visual. Adding all of these things make your audience's brain fire like crazy. This single spot is one of the most important things that the world doesn't talk about. So right now, you guys are lucky enough to have a bunch of information that like 99% of the world ignores or gets terrible misinformation about. And this comes through like thousands of hours of trial and error and testing and all sorts of stuff. So I assure you, this works ridiculously well. So it's not that the stuff is bad, it's just that there's only a little bit. And I want to hear more about who you are, what you want to do, how to connect with you, all that stuff. So far, so good?
Yes.
Honestly, right after that, a lot of the other stuff is like minor details. I'm going to give you a couple other things, and then I want to go straight into questions, if that's cool. So this is like the dreaded thing that I can't stand. You see how there's no logo there? That could just be that Calvary Chapel Arrowhead has no LinkedIn page. Double check, Tanner, see if they do. If they do, make sure that your experience aligns with it. Because the worst thing in the world is when it has that. Because it looks like you're just making up a fake company. And it's terrible, right? Like if you look at mine, and we can go through some of that other stuff that I've got on there. So I've got mine. I, again, have the media things. And some places that I write at. But I hate that I'm a contributing writer for this place. And they literally, they like just don't even have a LinkedIn page, or they didn't put a logo. That's out of my control. Whatever, you know, but that's what we got. So, you know, you can add a little more. If you can add media pieces to it, that's always good. Also, you will come to a point in your career where everything you do isn't necessarily relevant. So Tanner, like you want to do writing and stuff. So eventually being a service clerk might just fall off. I don't list everything I've ever done, and that's fine. Education looks good. It looks really good. Skills and endorsements, you can get other people to endorse you. And you can also reorder them. So it doesn't have to be in the number of things that people did, but you want people to like endorse you in like writing and editorial and stuff like that. So make sure that you have those skills that are endorsable. Then there's also recommendations. This is, it's a little more old school, but since you guys are just kind of starting out, I'd make sure that you give and receive some different things. And, you know, just make sure it's something that kind of stands out and all that. Then you have interests. So let's say you you want to write somewhere, you're interested in something, you can add some interests in here. There are many, many other categories that you're probably not even close to maxed out. Like if you look at my profile, it's just like, it goes on for just like pages and pages, and I have volunteer experiences, featured skills, recommendations, accomplishments are certainly really interesting, interests. I put honors and awards. I put a test score on here. I actually put my MBTI, if you guys ever took that psychological assessment, clearly it says I'm crazy. No, no, it says I'm an ENTP, which is supposed to be like a visionary, big picture guy. Yep. So volunteer stuff, if you guys do that, that's really good. There was one other section I wanted to show you. Hold on. articles and activity will change your life. Start writing things, okay? Here's how you write things. You go log in, and then it says share an article, photo, video, or idea. Not everybody in the world has video rolled out to them yet. If it has been rolled out to you, make a video. There are different hashtags that the LinkedIn community goes. When you do a search on LinkedIn, not only can you search for people and companies, but you can search by content, you can search by hashtag. And if you ever look in the upper right, kind of like Facebook's news, LinkedIn has news and it shows you what's hot right now. Not only does it show you the top five, but if you click on show more, you can do the top 10. So if you don't know what to write about, there's stuff going on. I personally write pretty much once a day. I know that's hard, but it will get you noticed like you can't believe. Just to give you a sense, like without $1 of any advertising or paid anything, the highest my posts have ever reached are about 1 million organic views. Even on a bad day, I'd say 5,000 to 10,000 people look at every single thing that I do. To the point where if I comment on one of your things that you write, that in and of itself might make your post like go viral. And going viral is nice, but like getting a certain kind of audience around you. And what's cool about LinkedIn is it shows you analytics to show you like what kind of role people are, where they are in the country, where they are in the world, and what kinds of companies they work for. So let's say you wanted to go get a job at Amazon. You could literally just like write a post about Amazon. And guess what? Like people from Amazon will look at it. Like real people. Imagine that. So like when it comes to getting a job, instead of just like going through the front door, you can network with all these people and totally get it, which is why we're doing these things. I want to briefly talk about three kinds of content, and then I'd like to open to questions. Krista, how much more time do we have?
15 minutes.
Okay, so I'll go fast. So three kinds of major content right now. If you want to click this box, you have 2,000 characters, which is not a whole lot of words. That's like 8 tweets or 10, well, they doubled it, whatever. It's like 4 tweets. Anybody can write short thoughts in here. It's very easy, and then you post. You can tag people by doing the at thing, just like on Facebook. You can tag companies, you can tag people. You can add images to it. Don't just share links. Actually write stuff, and it works really well. You can add videos. You can add native videos, or you can put in other videos. I would suggest you put in native videos because LinkedIn likes talking about LinkedIn. People love talking about LinkedIn on LinkedIn. Surprise, surprise. Something that's interesting on video also, if you do it from your phone, they actually are rolling out geotags, just like Snapchat, Insta, all these places. Usually they're more about conferences, or it'll say like your work best friend or where what you're working on, and there's some fun filters that you can actually add on it. A lot of this stuff most people don't know about because it's just come in the last few months. Also, if you want to write, I'm just going to refresh my screen. If you want to write a long form post, like if you have a lot of stuff to say, you can click on write an article. This takes you to the LinkedIn publisher platform where you can really write like a big long form article. These are good and they're bad. Like for the short form post, you only get to see analytics the last 30 days, then it goes away. These you can see analytics forever. I would say when you're starting out, not so much on the publishing side, but actually people really favor the short form posts. Most people will write things every other line. BuzzFeed called it broetry and everybody makes fun of it, but it's really easy and consumable to read on mobile. So I don't care what people make fun of. I care what's effective. And I will tell you for sure, it's super effective. Like I have a friend, Chris, you probably know him, Coca Sexton. So Coca used to actually work for LinkedIn, then he worked for Hootsuite. He invented social selling, and Hootsuite just laid off a bunch of people. And I wrote a thing last night, just to give you a sense of like how much people look at stuff. I wrote something, why people should hire him, yesterday, like late yesterday. And look at this, it's nuts. Here's the thing I wrote, how many hours ago, let's see. 18 hours ago, and I'm just like, can you help him get a job? Here's him, here's places he's looking at. That's how short it is. 13,000 people looked at this already. You think that'll help him get a job? I do. By the way, 287 people from LinkedIn looked at it. Like all the places that he wanted to reach are looking at it because of that. Even somebody shared it. I don't even know who this person is. It's insane, right? So you can write for what you want. So do it. Cool. So let's open it up to some questions.
We have questions. I know you guys all submitted some.
I tried to like, you know, just catch up for lost time there and probably went a little fast on some of that. But I can always send you guys recording and we can take it piece by piece. So what do you guys think?
Tanner has one.
Yeah. What's up?
So obviously I've got some work to do on LinkedIn. Thank you for that direction. I noticed that looking at your profile, you actually, and you've already said this too, you were in tech. And then
I'm having a little trouble hearing you. Can you come up a little bit?
Okay, so I viewed your LinkedIn profile, and you said that you just up and left tech at one point, went to the Midwest, started a new gig, and I was wondering, as someone who obviously wants to leave the realm of the W-2, as you said, how do you effectively do that while also having like a safety net so that, you know, you're still able to provide for your family and stuff?
Right. Yeah, everybody wants to be like the 18-year-old millionaire that works 4 hours a week and sits on the beach. But most people, like the guy who writes the 4-hour work week, doesn't work 4 hours a week. So a lot of that life is a lie. So I like what you're saying because you're couching what you're saying in practicality. I would say before you just go and like have your million-dollar idea, your idea probably sucks because it hasn't been, there's not enough breath of life into it yet, right? So let's say you have something that you want to do. Do you really know how much to charge? Do you really know how to write a contract so you won't get screwed and they won't pay you? I mean, there's so many things. There's a big difference between being a subject matter expert in this world and being a business owner. There's a lot of stuff that you have to do that is not so pretty when being a business owner. You have to hire people. You have to fire people. I mean, you know, you basically like one day, 1 hour, your name is in lights, and the next hour, there's a million fires going on. You have to be the janitor. I mean, it's ridiculous, like all the stuff you have to do. So I would say, before you make the job of your dreams, don't kill the job of your dreams and don't quit your day job, right? So, I mean, I left the last place I was at. I'm like, hey, I really want to just do my own thing. Will you be my client? And they said yes. So that helped me springboard, okay? I would recommend for anyone who asks a question like that, there's a great book called Quitter, not Twitter, but Quitter with a Q-U by John Acuff. So John had this same problem where he basically, not to, you know, TLDR, not to ruin the whole book for you, but basically it's like, learn the experience while getting paid regularly, don't quit your day job, and allow your side hustle, side gig career to blossom and develop. And the right kind of job will let you do that. Make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Cool. Good question.
Who else has a question? Social media, LinkedIn.
Yeah, whatever you want. It doesn't just have to be about LinkedIn. I just figured this would be like really beneficial for as many people as possible.
Super.
You want to look at infographics? Here, I'll bring one up.
I'm going to pull up some of their questions they submitted.
Oh, you have some questions already? What's up?
Oh, no, you go ahead. I have to pull some up. They had to submit 2 questions apiece, so I have 104 questions supposedly in here.
Holy cow. Okay, let's go through some questions. Okay. What's up?
I got to get there. So if you wanted to show an infographic, show this Amazon one. I know I've shared this, but I don't know if they've all seen
this. This is really cool. This was for a company called Sellbrite, and it was kind of like a really narrow audience where they basically, like, if you have like an Amazon seller account, they can help you. But I'm like, guys, like, that's really limiting. Let's just do a whole piece talking about how Amazon makes money. So first off, that's like a natural curiosity and interest. Secondly, look how cool that is, right? It's this guy sitting on a throne with piles of money, and he's got a crown, and he's got an Amazon box with a smile as a head while he's smiling, just taking all your money. So there's all this stuff like firing off in your brain, and that makes you want to look on. We also have some amazing stats in here, which also kind of satisfy that itch in your mind. I'm not going to show you the stat yet. Ready? Check this out. So we made this at the end of last year, so the 2017 stats weren't out yet. But in 2016, how much money do you guys think Amazon made on unused gift cards?
Unused
gift cards. How much?
$600,000.
$600 million, huh? No, not really. Keep going.
Up.
Oh, big up. Yeah, you kidding me? I'm going to make this bigger. $2.4 billion with a B. Right? Everybody just went, holy crap, that's really interesting. So did the media. So when you're building things like this, if you can make a stat that just melts your brain and is verifiable, the news goes crazy on that. That's the kind of thing that you could just see like all the talking heads in radio and TV just like saying, I'm a $2.4 billion, blah, 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 right? But it's enough to like get the left and right side of your brain excited, right? It's analytical and it's human, right? Everybody could be like, oh, I hate Amazon. Oh, I want to go support mom and pop shops. Yet there's like 10 Amazon packages on your doorstep. Come on, who are we kidding? Right? So it's like a natural curiosity that flows from a funnel where everybody's interested in what Amazon is, all the way down to here's different stuff that you could do. Like here's, you know, if you're an Amazon seller, you can make all sorts of money. Here's the different categories you can do it. And you'll notice like it's visually very rich and appealing. We made all of these icons by hand. We didn't just go to some stock photography site or whatever. So we do all this crazy stuff. And then it just, it runs like fire all over the web. Like you guys have heard of Business Insider, right? I mean, that's a huge piece of the internet and 13,000 people just saw it on that one thing. So that's kind of what we do in a nutshell. We just basically make a lot of money just helping tell better stories for companies and stuff. Just making it like, not just like a really boring all about me thing, but like all about you, the audience, the consumer, the person who has choice. So what other questions do you have?
One of the good questions I just saw was, what does a typical day look like for you? I don't know if you have one, but
what is what?
A typical workday look like for you?
I don't. My workday is insane. I don't even know where to start. Because I have that calendar link, a lot of people just want mentorship and advice. And what do I do about LinkedIn? So much so that I actually just started doing like some very limited coursework teaching people about LinkedIn for money. That's not an upsell to get you guys to do that, but just, you know, it turned into like a whole like side business for us, because there's such a ridiculous demand. So there's that. People, we're the top ranked infographic place in the nation. So like all day long, like people are like, I want an infographic on that. I want an infographic on that. A lot of my friends are like, hey, did you ever consider making an infographic like X? Or why don't you just do one? And it's like, we can't just make one. Like we have to have people like buy the things to do it. And more often than not, we have so much repeat business that usually if we have a good idea, we can just sell it. I'd say a very hot thing in the world right now, everything Bitcoin, cryptocurrency, blockchain, we're probably working on at least half a dozen simultaneous different clients about everything in that market because it's just really interesting. We're really good at Trivial Pursuit because we just know a lot about what's going in the world, a lot of things that are secret and private, but like we have a lot of knowledge about a lot of different industries. So my day is very random and fast-paced, and every day I just wake up and I'm very blessed to have a business like this. It's really cool. And we just have a lot of fun. We're a little weird. It's not very corporate. The team's a little distributed. We have two main offices out in the Midwest, and then there's a few other people that are remote in other parts. But yeah, it's kind of crazy. So if you not, it's not for everybody, right? So like, if you like just a really boring 9-to-5, just staring at Excel spreadsheets, like you would hate this. It'd be nails against the chalkboard. But for other people, it's like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Hope that answers the question.
And you travel a lot both for clients and for speaking, right?
I try not to travel a lot because I have a large family. So I have 6 kids and this agency, which I call my 7th kid. So I feel like there's only so many things you get to do in life. And if I traveled nonstop, I feel like I wouldn't have a whole lot of family life. I'm also a religious person that observes the Sabbath. So a lot of speaking gigs don't really work for me, either Jewish holidays or the Sabbath. So if somebody's holding something on Saturday, I'm like, sorry, can't do it. You know. So I don't know. Eventually I may change the way this is. Like if, I don't know, if I'm not the CEO anymore, or if I retire, if we sell it or something, I don't know. We may change that. I go to only a select amount of events just because it doesn't always work. Lately, I've been traveling a lot, but a lot of the kind of work that we do, they're such quick projects anyway. People don't necessarily need to meet me face-to-face because we can always do video, we can always do calls. And I mean, there's places we've actually worked with for years that I've never even met the people. And I mean, you know, if somebody wants to hire us in like Singapore or something, I'm not going to fly all the way out to Singapore. It's like, yay, we're here. Yep, I'm going to make you an infographic. So I don't know. It's not necessarily the thing that everybody does. I know it's like to be a social media person, you have to write a book and you have to go everywhere. And I don't necessarily think that that's true. There's tons of stuff I can do with all the stuff I do. I'm on some kind of guest lecture, podcast interview or whatever, literally every week. There was a point a few months ago where I was on 3 different podcasts, 3 days in a row on 3 different continents. I'm like, I'm not getting enough work done. So we're limiting all this to just do something weekly at the most. And otherwise, like, I wouldn't have a calendar anymore. So yeah, it's crazy. It's a little crazy.
All right, we have time for probably one more question.
Okay.
Burning question. Nobody? Well, I know that he, if you guys reach out to him, connect with him, he'll be happy to do that. And if you guys don't stop being shy and have a question.
Yeah, come on. Like, this is, I'm here to help, right? Like, I'm not just a talking head. You're smart too. That's why you're here.
going once, going twice. Anybody? All right. Well, our time is up, basically up, and they're being quiet. So you might get an explosion of questions by email or something later or LinkedIn. But
yeah, feel free to shoot it out. Send any questions. I mean, we could even make like a LinkedIn group if people feel safer in numbers or something. I don't bite. Like, I'm here to help you guys. Whatever. By the way, with LinkedIn groups, like literally like 4 days ago, LinkedIn groups used to be terrible and spammy. They are spending a lot of time making it better. So if you don't actually have a LinkedIn group for class, that might actually be a pretty cool idea.
That's a good idea. I will check it out because so far I've always had spammy experiences. So.
Yeah. It's totally different now. Yep. Totally.
All right. Well, let's thank you very much for the time, Brian.
Thank you, guys.
Enjoy. I'm sure I'll talk to you again. Thank you again. I really appreciate it. I hope you have a great day.
My pleasure. Bye, everybody.
Bye. See ya. All right. So hopefully that was viable.
Still there.
Is it?
We're still there. Yeah.
Lead meeting. There we go.